Okay, I'm going to open the meeting. All right, it is now 6:30 p.m. on Thursday, April the 4th, and the Select Board of Newfane is called to order. The first order of business is the March 21st meeting minutes. Do I have a motion to accept the minutes? Been moved, moved and seconded. Discussion, additions, and corrections.
I have some, but I just took hers. Anybody else have any?
Well, just the only thing I want to make sure is that the motion that we passed about the town meeting is, I would like us all to take a quick look at it and make sure we're okay on the, on that. Where would that be? We had a motion was made that approved. Oh, okay. Be a member of five, that going to be the committee be a minimum of five members, maximum of seven, be appointed by the Spirit of Planning, proposing a plan or plans for the improving, including rough cost estimates for each project. This plan, yeah, that certainly looks like exactly what I said. So that was moved and seconded and approved. Okay, I just wanted to make sure that was in there because that is an important motion. Okay. Are there any additions, corrections, whatever?
Well, on page one, under road business, wasn't Gunther's suggestion to use the property at the school as a gravel pit and not for storing gravel?
Yes.
Okay. So if you change storing to delete the word storing and add the word pit. Other corrections?
To delete the word storing.
And add the word pit after the word gravel.
I was putting pit.
Hello?
Pit gravel. Yeah. And then on page two.
Otherwise, you end up storing the pit.
John, right in that where you were talking about, kind of mid. So the sentence starts to the select board. It shouldn't have an apostrophe, but that's not
okay,
for consider for
it's consi- yeah it's does not have an apostrophe.
But
so.
For its consideration for a set period of within 6 months.
Yeah, we just said for within. You can delete for a set period,
yeah,
and of delete for a set period of.
So it just goes consideration within 6 months.
Exactly.
I think we did say some wording like that. But that
well, I started to say for a set period, and then we discussed what, and we resolved 6 months would be good.
And then under new business, the very first sentence, John suggested that the town treasurer provide the select board and monthly reports.
It should be with.
The end, or?
Well, I think.
That she provide.
With.
Yeah,
the select board monthly reports are with.
With. It's just a discussion item. We did not have a motion, but just with instead of and. Do you see that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And then it seemed to me on page three, hazardous mitigation grant program and not process.
Where is that?
That's the very first line under HMGP update on page three.
Somehow.
See,
HMGP update.
Yeah, I print it from.
It's just a different page.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, here we go. Okay.
It is program rather than process. You see that it's at the under it HMGP. It is program.
And then it seemed to me, and Chris, maybe you can answer this, and Todd, the Wispall culvert money comes from that hazardous mitigation grant. So to say that we received a federal grant is that it's an H.
It is. It's
is
actually
federal.
Coming
that
from
is
the federal.
Federal.
But it's, I mean, it's almost, it's another part of this,
yes,
like the buyouts and whatnot, so.
Well, we could just say it for simplicity, just, I mean, it's fine. I think it's fine.
Yeah,
I do too. I mean, it's just federal money.
Fine.
If you get it.
another, but I misplaced that.
All right. And if there's any further discussion, hearing none, all those in favor of accepting the minutes as amended?
Aye.
Okay, that passes. And we move to the road foreman, road commissioner's report. Bob?
Yeah, we're still in mud season. Some of the roads are still pretty muddy, like Wardsboro Road. Some of them are starting to dry out. We've been hauling stone and actually been hauling some what I call dead sand. I'm putting them into the real muddy spots, and that sand has been amazing. It packs right down in there, makes the road pretty nice, so we can use quite a bit of that.
What is it, why do you call it dead sand? Is it just
it's the type of sand you take like this and it stays in the ball in your hand.
That's like beach sand.
Yeah. But it's been working really well. The mud season is nowhere near as bad as it was last year. I think a couple of weeks we should be out of it, I hope. We started grading some of the roads. Some of the roads are graded a couple times now, and they're still pretty wet, but some of them are shaping up, but a lot of them are pretty rough still, but they will be until the water starts coming out of the ground. As far as equipment goes, the 09 Sterling went up to Patriot for rear spring work. That was covered under warranty. It also had a heater problem. That was covered under warranty. The new Mac went to State Line Truck Service for its first service. When they delivered the truck, the dealer wanted to make sure it went back over there for its first service, and they went all over that truck. They spent like 2 hours making sure everything was okay with it. We'll do the next service, or the services are now on ourselves. The fuel tank testing, which is the self-certification that Pat and I have been working on with the state for the tanks at the garage. A company called Beardsley had to come down and do some testing around the fuel tanks. They said that the tanks are, they passed with flying colors. He said the tanks almost tested as good as new ones, which he was really surprised about. So he said that they should be good for a long time. The culvert inventory, I did get a hold of Jeff Nugent from Windham Regional. He has got it set up to have somebody come up here sometime in May and go over everything with us. I asked him if we could get them to go around with us again.
Yeah.
The truck specs, I should have them done next week, and I'll have Pat send them out. I did talk to Maureen, and she said she's fine with it because we're going to borrow all the money, so it doesn't really affect her.
Assuming we're able to borrow all the money.
Right. The loose slate out front of the town office has been fixed, put a bunch of dirt around it and stuff, and packed it down. I plan to bring the back over here at some point to backdrag some of the sand gravel off the lawn so the market's not doing all. Town Highway 3 candidate list, it's a list that Windham Regional comes up with for all the towns in Windham County. They have the arch bridge down as number 2 now for the county, which is good.
Where was it?
It was at 5.
Sorry, shouldn't be interrupted.
No, it was at 5. Now it's down to 2. I added Pat Gray Bridge, which was on your list before. That bridge, the couple of beams are, the webbing, which is on the top of the beams, is rotted off. And they claim it's got 95% section loss. That's the bridge we added 2 temporary beams under last year to try to hold it until they could do something with it.
What do you mean by section loss?
Well, that particular section where it's all rotted away, there's nothing holding it because the flat webbing's gone. So if you just go, it could buckle at any time.
So
but they said with the other 2 beams under there, it should hold it. So the other bridge is the bridge number 48, River Road Bridge. That bridge is listed in less than fair condition with bad I-beams and a deck. That I'm hoping to get a grant from John Alexander for. He mentioned it last year, and hopefully we get it. Roadside mowing bids needs to go out. It'll be the same bids as last year. Should get it done this time of year, so we'll get the job done in August or early September instead of November. And same thing with the paving bids, but Pat and I have been trying to get a hold of John Alexander, set up a meeting here with him to go over state aid to the town and paving grant, and I haven't been able to get a hold of him, so did you get a hold of him?
I've left him messages, but I just think they're busy.
All right.
Is there a motion to accept the road foreman road commissioner's report?
So moved.
Seconded.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. I made a note as you were talking about John. I remember we always start kind of the
like
new
town meeting.
Right. And so, Pat, yeah, Pat and Todd, please keep getting them in here. And I attended last time. I wanted to come in for that.
Yeah.
Let's see. In terms of the truck, do we need to get move? At what point do we need to get moving on getting the loan for the truck? How does that sequence work? What has to happen?
Well, you probably get the bids sent out and get them back.
The bids first.
Yeah. Then you'll know what you have to spend, you know, once you get the bids back.
Right.
We can't do anything really until after
July 1st.
Oh, good point. Fair point.
Right. That's what we put in the bid. Usually it takes about 3 months to get a cab and chassis.
Right.
And then, as you know, the body company screwed us around until almost December, putting the rest of it together. That's why I want to get it out, so that we get the truck before.
So we need to get that up. The only other question, I just want to make sure this is this, that the when we post roads as being 24,000, we're supposed to put something up on a website, an online registry. Are you aware of that from Steve Ovens?
I just saw that, yeah.
So, could you make
do it now?
Well, is it? I mean,
yeah, there was a date.
There was a deadline.
February something.
Oh, yeah.
It was supposed to have been done by February something.
Really?
Didn't do it. Yeah. There's another one that John Alexander sent out saying about the same thing. Said it had to be posted. Had to be within the state, posted in the state by February something.
But how do you know in February which roads are going to be posted in
pretty much the same ones. Almost every year.
Uh-huh. All right, so I mean, this memo that I'm seeing doesn't put a date on it.
Yeah, we got something sent out on the emails with John.
Right, I just make sure that's kind of copacetic. You know,
we had to post it in three places, which we did.
Okay,
it was here.
WW
in the Williams.
Right, I remember that. So I'm just seeing the online thing and just making sure that should happen. Okay, this is the same thing. Okay, any other discussion on the road foreman road commissioner's report?
Yeah, so Todd, are you doing the response back to Matt Mann on these bridge lists?
I've already done.
So this is done?
Yeah.
Okay, that's great.
So to Matt, but it's really from Ashley Collins, but I guess it's the same. It's Wyndham Regional.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what are you saying to him?
I emailed you. Remember
that? Okay.
That we agreed with the Arch Bridge.
Okay.
As our first.
Okay.
And we put down Pat Gray Bridge, and we put down River Road.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. All right. Excellent. Excellent. Okay, any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor of accepting the road foreman road commissioner's report?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously. Next item business is roadside mowing bids. So what's the story on that, Todd?
It'd be the same bid we put out last year, just have to change the dates.
So you work with Pat to get that bid out?
Last year's bid should be in the final
part. Yeah, yes.
Okay. Now, the paving bids, do we have to wait till we meet with John?
Yeah, we don't know how much money we're going to have.
That's the next item. But all right, so we have to wait. Hold on that till we talk to John. To meeting with John. Alexander. The bridge inspection we've talked about. The town highway bridge pre-candidate list we've talked about. Okay, the next order of business is the scheduled members of the public. The first is Jenny for the Senior Solutions.
Yes, I'm representing Senior Solutions, and what it does is, in fact, I made copies. It's in the middle of the page.
Thank you.
It's in regard to the meeting in 2011.
Mm-hmm.
And the minutes that were in this year's annual report, the town meeting.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
That I did make a motion for $200 more for seniors,
uh-huh,
for Senior Solutions.
Mm-hmm.
And it was never received.
They got
their $750,
okay,
but they did not get the $200.
Did they ask for $750 or did they ask for $950?
The letter from Senior Solutions, I believe, might have asked for more. I'm not sure what that letter stated. But the budget did,
mm-hmm,
you had in there $750 is what you were willing to expend. And at the town meeting, I asked for 200
right.
more.
Understood.
And it passed
right.
Unanimously.
Right.
So you're short the...
So bottom line is they only got 750.
Right.
I just understand they may have been that they only sent in for 750. I don't know. It never came back to us as an issue till now.
Okay.
So, but I so what do we need to pass a motion to just authorize the treasurer to pay it, or has it yet? It has not yet been paid.
Correct.
So we're gonna have to pay it out of this year's budget, but okay. That's. Life in the big city.
Right.
Well, actually, we're still in last year, so
no, we're still
in the fiscal year. So,
okay.
So all we really need to do is to authorize the. So, do I hear a motion to this effect?
Make a motion. We authorize the treasurer to send a check to Senior Solutions for $200.
Seconded.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Motion passes unanimously. Okay, so we will make sure that Pat, would you please just make a, you know.
Yes,
send an email to Maureen that we did pass a motion that $200 additional should be paid to Senior Solutions. Thank you, Jenny, very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay, the next item of business is the town plan approval, but I don't see Tristan. What I do know, independent of whether Tristan is here, I suppose we could move it down, but the bottom line is this: they did hold a hearing, though, as it turns out, no one was there other than the committee, but okay, such is that, that's the way it is. And they did unanimously, following the committee, motion to submit turn as printed to select board as written,
yes.
And it was moved and passed. So, strictly speaking, that should have happened after the close of the public hearing, but that's not my problem. Okay, so we need that now. The ball is in our court. We need to hold a hearing on the plan, and so we'll need to schedule that hearing. I don't know what the notice requirement is. Does anyone happen to know the notice requirement for the hearing that we hold on it readopting the town plan? So it's either 30 or 45 days.
30, but
let's if we're to be safe, suppose we say it's 40. Maybe, I don't know if I can find it immediately to find out. I probably cannot locate it quickly enough.
Well, do we want to be on the safe side?
Yeah,
just
say 45. So if today is the 4th, and so 45 days from now would be the 49th of the month. Minus 31 is the 8th. So sometime after May 18th, we need to hold this hearing, and obviously we want to do it as reasonably quickly as we can to move this forward, because there are certain things, you know, we could be held up on if we don't have a town plan and that's been approved. So
we have a select board meeting on the 16th of May.
We do have a select board, and I'm just independent of anything else, I am informing the select board I will not be present for that meeting. So Todd, you're going to be
lucky me.
You're lucky you. Does anyone have a thought about a possible time? We could have the hearing as they did, kind of just they folded it into their meeting. We could have it at a set time within the regular meeting, or we could have it at a 6 o'clock prior to the meeting. What's the thought is to combine it with the regular meeting so we don't need a second trip.
Is there the 16th?
On the 16th. Is that enough
you're
time?
You're saying 45 days.
Well, I'm guessing.
Days,
I don't know. What did I
we'd
say?
We'd have to have, you
oh,
said
it has to be the next
18th.
One. It'd have to be the next one if that were true.
See, and then that would take us all the way into June.
Yeah, it takes, let's just see, maybe I can find it. Suppose we had a motion to have it on that first meeting if we only need to give a 30-day warning. contingent on that. And if we need a 45-day, then we make it at the following meeting. How does that seem to be?
So what's the first meeting date?
So the
May 16th?
Correct. So we would have it on May 16th, contingent on that our only meeting 30 days to give the warning, and May, whatever the next one is.
No, it wouldn't be June.
It would have to go, unless we set a special meeting.
Right.
So we'll meet in between. Well, no, we'll lose time.
The attendance will be so underwhelming.
Yeah, I understand. But we'll have to be.
Yeah.
Well, let's just make it the next regular meeting. So if it does require 45 days, then it would be the first meeting in June. Is that the 6th? Is that that? Yeah, I see that. So that would be the 6th. Okay, Pat, if you would look into that and then warn it appropriately, whether it's 30 or 45, that would be terrific.
Okay.
So I guess it would be best if we had a motion to do that.
So moved.
It's been moved.
Second.
And seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, that passes unanimously. Okay, very good. It is great that we're moving forward, and I'm very pleased that the Planning Commission is kind of moving forward with their work. The next piece, and I see, by the way, that they're also making some progress on the bylaws, so that's very good.
Well, they had done a lot of work on the bylaws, and then...
Then they got kind of, unfortunately, this was a priority. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right, the next is the member of the public is the Windham County Sheriff's Department. Mark, you want to... give us a report.
Good evening again. This month we responded to 13 calls for service, nothing really of any significant interest. We did assist state police with a couple things that they were unable to respond to because they were tied up. I am aware that the state police are investigating a few burglaries that have occurred in town. To what degree, I can't speak to that effect. So that is currently going on right now. As far as this month, we provided 28 hours of service to the town of Newfane, of which 16 was billed for and 12 were provided through other means, including our DUI team, which was out in the town. We generated 26 tickets for speed violations, as well as a ticket for operating without a license. And a couple things, with spring coming around, we're starting to pull out our speed carts. So I'm not sure if the board's aware of any locations that you've heard of. We certainly have a few places in town that we're going to be putting it. Being in South Newfane near Janus Drive, that area will receive it at some point, probably towards the Green Iron Bridge in South Newfane as well. And then a couple places along 30 as well as up on South Forestville Road.
Could you hold it? People want to, if they play spots, people would really like to see those things?
River Road, maybe.
River Road?
Towards Winchester Stables.
Okay.
When we're trying to do work over there, they fly up and down that road.
Okay.
Go ahead, Mark.
That's part of the notes. We did do the ticket training this past week, which both Pat and Maureen attended, as well as I believe 8 other municipalities. So they've received that, and we also have the training aids, which have been distributed to everybody who attended. So we hope that worked out for everyone. We've heard good things from as feedback from some of the people who attended. One of the things that's coming up in the near future for the Sheriff's Department, we're changing our records management system to a new system that's slated to begin the 1st of May. Because of that change, I'm not sure to what degree I'll be able to output reports as we have been. STARS reports won't be affected. So I'm not quite sure the type of data that we're going to be able to spit out just yet, but from what we understand, it'll be more effective for what we need. And so.
Okay.
Just to give you some forewarning that we might have a couple of hiccups in the reporting process.
Right.
Yeah, I worked in computers and I never saw one go in
smoothly.
Without a hitch.
To that end, we are starting it as a slow transition process. We're going to maintain our current system for about a year. So we should still have the old system. We should be able to access information from years past through that system as well. But first and main is the goal, and that's what we're hoping for. Other than that, I really don't have anything else.
Okay. The one question I'd ask Pat, having gone to the training, do you feel like you can track? Do you feel you got what you needed in terms of?
Haven't had a chance to work with it yet or to try it out. Neither Maureen nor I, but we will. We will.
Okay. But you felt you understood how the process works and what you need to do.
I think it's going to be an easy process.
Okay, great. Great. Yeah. Thank you, Mark.
Take care.
Okay,
thanks,
take
Mark.
Care.
And actually, I'll leave this for you.
Thank you. Okay. The next order of business is unscheduled members of the public. Are there any unscheduled among the public who wish to speak?
I'll volunteer.
It's okay, Gunther, you don't have to.
I know. Just the initial report of the town offices repair committee. Yesterday, Mike, Dennis, and Pete went into the hellhole of Calcutta. They spent about an hour and a half down there taking pictures and surveying the whole place. Took about 100-some-odd pictures. And Mike will prepare an initial analysis. We have a meeting on Wednesday, and we should have a more detailed report at the next select board meeting.
Great. Well, just delighted you guys are working on it, and that you really look taking it, digging in. That's terrific. Any other unscheduled members of the public? All right. Hearing none, moving on to new business. And the key item of new business is that we are coming to the conclusion of our audit process. And Chris, do you want to tell us where we stand and what we need to do to conclude this process?
So a draft of there's actually two audit reports. One is the general town audit, and then there's a single audit for all the federal funds that have come through. And within that audit, there are recommendations. And where we stand right now is the board has drafted letters of response to those recommendations, things that the auditors feel that we can beef up in terms of our record keeping and implementation. So as soon as those go up to the auditors, we should have a hardbound copy for residents and all.
Great. Terrific. Now, I don't recall that did we send a response last year? I don't remember our actually drafting a response.
They made recommendations, but we never sent one back.
We never actually responded altogether last year or the year before. So that's good. This is better.
We
did. Yes, so you think we did?
It was by email.
Oh, okay.
And it was between Maureen and Shannon.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
This is actually, publicly I want to say, this is really a much more formal response.
Good.
Because there were some things, just because of all this money flowing through and all this, we wanted to make sure that if there are steps we need to take, that we take them to do whatever it is the auditors feel that we should do.
Well, so. I think it's important that, Pat, if you could distribute these to the members, I do think we should have a motion that we will...
Now, Maureen sent around late this afternoon the second... So when I did it, it said page 1, page 2, 38, 39, 40... So there seemed to be...
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
There seemed to be, with a single audit, those other points that you hadn't addressed in the...
That's why there are two letters.
So that's why there are two letters.
Yes.
So let me just pass it to you.
I can explain those so that at least everybody's clear on it, I think.
Okay, this is where...
The first set of responses, which is 12-1 through 12-5... are responses to the general audit conditions. 12-6 through 12-9 are specific to the federal awards single audit.
Yeah. Okay.
And we didn't get that.
Yeah, I haven't seen a copy of that yet, of their draft letter for the single audit.
Did I? Yes, that just came in. Did I make a copy of that? Well, I have one set out.
So if you could, I think to all the board members, if you would send out a copy of it.
Yeah.
So this is our response. If you could just walk us through, so I think there's some importance to this. So if you could walk us through the...
You got a copy, Chris?
No.
I'm going to hand you this.
Come on, Trish.
I'll just do it right out of my head.
That's by memory. You haven't memorized
these yet? Wasn't it 11:56 last night when you sent that out?
Okay, so Chris, if you could just walk us through each of these items and our response to them.
So some of these are more significant than others in that sense, but in the general audit, segregation of duties, and what they've said this several times, because we're a small area, it's very hard to get someone to do the bank reconciliations that isn't the same person who's the check writing authority. Mm-hmm. We've been through this for several years. If they're making that recommendation again, and we're saying that we'll try to implement procedure to create this division of duties. And in fact, we'll get there.
We did provide budgeting for it for the fiscal year 2013-14. So.
And we were about that close to seeing if Marilyn would.
Mm-hmm. Right, and we did get some. Yeah. We did do some of it, and Neil Pelsa did do it for several months.
For several months, that's right.
Okay.
12.2 is revenue recognition. What they're saying here is we did have general journal entry corrections that had to be made. And frankly, when a lot of the funds were coming in from various different sources, part of the confusion I can just say publicly is we had Bridge 14 in South Newfane that was just a regular, we're going to fix this bridge going on. At the same time that we're also putting federal award funds through for all kinds of other bridges. So it was quite easy to get certain things confused.
Mm-hmm.
The auditors are simply saying implement a policy to make sure that there's a secondary person to kind of tag that to make sure that they can catch the corrections earlier.
Oh, so it's actually the recommendation is for a person to be involved?
Well, I think it's what we would have had with Dan, right?
No. That's on the treasurer's side. In other words,
and actually, the
implementation would be the person who might be doing check reconciliation.
Okay, could possibly handle that.
Check, exactly.
Okay.
12.3, capitalization of property, plant, and equipment. The auditors, this is a standard thing. We need to go back through again this year and do an inventory of all our equipment and everything that we have and make sure that we have that on file.
Okay.
Authorization of general journal entries, which is 12.4. Basically, what the auditors said on this one is, if we do any general journal entries, the board and the public should be made aware of those.
Okay.
So any corrections or changes... That way, within our accounting records, there's a notation on it, and the board knows, we goofed and we need to take $30,000 out of there, put it over here, and it's not something odd.
Gotcha.
That's all that is.
Mm-hmm.
Accounting and Procedures Manual, which is 12.5 on the recommendation. They do recommend that we have some form of manual, and to that end, we've contacted VLCT to see if we've just got a nice version that we can work with.
Good luck.
Thank you.
And I'm glad you, said we're trying to do it, but part of an overall.
It is.
It's going to take time.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that actually is the general.
Right.
Now to go to the.
Can I just add something on the 12.5? I'm wondering, as we work with the LCT, et cetera, can we break it down to see that it's like phase one, phase two, phase three, so that we could say to them, we'll get phase one done, so that we would actually accomplish something in terms of an accounting and procedures manual instead of just saying some year we'll get to it?
No, specifically in the responses that were made here, what we were trying to say to the auditing firm, because we're so close to now a 6/30/13 close date, yeah, that we recognize that that's an important thing, and essentially what we said is that the town doesn't anticipate the completion of that manual by the mm-hmm. year end, but that we completion of this recommendation will form a part of the overall implementation of corrections. Yeah, that way we don't get locked right into...
Yeah, I see that it's in the mode. All of these yeah. are very general, but the point is, you know, once we do get to it, maybe we can map out
yes.
the process so the next year they'll see, oh, yes, they've
well,
made
see,
this step
what,
in
yeah.
that.
And I think that because we're going to be single audited for the next 3 years, mm-hmm. so this is quite a bit of a process, we don't really, we will implement these changes. Mm-hmm. It's yeah. not going to be a matter of, well, these are going to go under the table. They really have to be implemented.
Right.
So, yeah. Yeah. So then we have a response that's separated strictly for the single audit of the mm-hmm. federal awards for the grant monies from FEMA. 12.6 is contract documents. When the flood mm-hmm. happened, okay, we pulled as many contractors that were known to us. Mm-hmm. We knew they weren't on the debarment mm-hmm. list from prior issues. Mm-hmm. We knew that they were good on their prior contracts. Many of these things occurred. In the world of the federal government, they don't care. They want you to go and spend the time to bid the contract, to do these things. In the case
whether
of
whether or not we knew about yeah, that requirement.
Well, actually, in the case of this flood that happened here, there was an emergency measure. And so some of these requirements were mm-hmm. Abated for a period of time. The auditors don't care about the time frame. They're just simply mm-hmm. binging us to make sure, hey, you realize that you need to get contract documents, you need to certify, that was 12-7. To make sure contractors aren't on a debarment list from the state. 12.8 is the Davis-Bacon Act, which says that any contractor that works for you pays a minimum under the Davis-Bacon Act of certain wages mm-hmm. and no less. And then the documentation of material used, which was 12.9.
Yeah. I mean, that was... 12.9 is just such a significant piece. You know, you had some a little bit used here and some used there.
Yeah. What we're talking about there is when the storm hit, we couldn't get from here to there in many, many cases. So the town and the board at the time and the town road crew, they had to have landing stages. So we would procure material mm-hmm. and it would end up here, and then it's got to get picked back up by another contractor and go to where it needs to go at a later time when we can get through, mm-hmm. okay? The logging of material slips and tracking of that, the federal government says that at any point you make the procurement to purchase, you must track that load of stuff all the way through until it's in the ground again or it's used mm-hmm. for whatever purpose. You can't imagine that there would be some difficulty in that.
Just how difficult
yeah.
that would be.
So, but I personally think for what we had going, they did a heck of a job. It was not that we didn't do a spreadsheet on this. We did. So all those recommendations are simply going back to the auditors saying, yes, we recognize these things. We'll make sure that in future we do a better job. And there you have it.
Makes sense. Discussion. Hearing none, I would like a motion. I think we don't have a motion on the table, but I would like a motion to that the select board will agrees to sign these documents to for return to our auditors.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. So we should be sure to sign. You have the that's where you have
Todd.
Todd has the one on letterhead. So we'll all sign those and make sure that gets conveyed. Great. And I just want to thank Chris for the absolutely marvelous job that she has done and the amount of work that she's done to work with the auditors. I think they have a lot of respect for Chris and a lot of trust in Chris, which is a huge thing. And they know that when, you know, trying to do everything absolutely above board, and if we're, if we can't do the, you know, if we didn't do things one way or another, we will, we'll be very straightforward about what we did do.
Exactly.
And that's all we can do. And I think Chris has done a just marvelous job in working with him. So I think she deserves our thanks.
Yeah, she puts a lot of time in.
You're welcome.
Thank God you're on again.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. That brings us to old business. And the first piece of old business is the Long-Term Recovery Committee. Gloria, you want to talk about that?
Yeah, I think it's been so long since maybe I mentioned that. I think this is on there because received an email from the coordinator or somebody from the Long-Term Recovery Committee, and they're offering work groups. So what would be great is to figure out, they'll have somebody here, they'll have the equipment, they'll do everything for us, but we need projects in the town for them to do, along with, you know, we've got 2 to 3 weeks of the Vermont Youth Conservation Corps.
Mm-hmm.
So I emailed back to the woman and said, I think that we should have something. And John suggested that I come up with ideas myself,
yes, I did.
Which I didn't do because it's a hard one. I see all sorts of work that we could do on Dover Road if those buyouts.
We don't own the property.
Get
this
done. But also, in terms of grubbings, I talked to Mark Pickering, and he said we can put grubbings in within the right of way, the town right of way. So you take Dover Road and you do our right-of-way, one side and the other, we've got place for them to work.
Mm.
So the next step would be, and I've talked to Mark, is he'll come and help determine how much in terms of grubbings we need. I think we stop there, though, in that we can get the grubbings through the, I think it's the hazardous mitigation plan, or it may be the block, community block grant, but we have to have a 25% matching from the town. So we would have to come up with, you know, how can we match that, depending on how much it is and how much it costs, but we'd have free labor to get that in. So,
is there any thought about this?
Is there any way, if you started with Mark Pickering, and he could give you an assessment on how much we'd be putting on, right? What the cost would be?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
You know, we could. There must be some way we could meet it out to say, okay, it's 2,000 or it's 1,000. That would be the 25% match.
Yeah, we really need some idea, because if it's a substantial number, then we really actually have to go back to the town for it, because we didn't budget for it. But I personally think it's something we should be looking into.
Because I had my calendar beat me and remind me to call Mark, but that was like the day of the last snowstorm.
Yeah, yeah.
I said, I don't think
so. Gloria, could you continue to ping Mark and see if we can get some help from him on what concretely might
be a
project and a rough idea of cost, so then we can kind of talk about it with something in front of us.
Absolutely.
Okay. I'd appreciate that. Okay. So Gloria will pursue. Okay. The next item on the agenda.
I knew
I would sooner or later lose the agenda. Yes.
Todd, you said you have some grubbing?
We've got some loam over there.
Some loam.
Which gets grown up in this stuff, so you can probably call it grubbings.
Okay.
You might even have some over there.
Yeah, so I think it would definitely be worth thinking through what could be helpful to make that area look a little bit less like
that one spot,
like a disaster happened.
where the house washed away on the other side.
Yeah, towards yeah, the that's the worst.
I mean, we probably got enough to do that.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Probably do a lot of it with a grader.
That would be
dump
terrific.
It, spread it with a grader.
Mm-hmm. Oh, because I think the 25% match is also in kind labor, that kind of thing too. So. Oh, it is.
Yeah. So track any if you do any of that, track your time and so on, because that could end up being our 25%.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
We get through mud season, then we can do some of that.
Right. Okay. Cool.
I could use some of the ditching material too. If you took, you know, ditching some logs, you could dump that on there and then grade it down.
Okay.
Good,
terrific.
One stone.
Terrific. All right. Now, is there anything further on that topic? Yeah. The next thing is the Williamsville Hall weatherization plans. I just skipped right over that.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. The Williams Wiswall
we're
Hill
skip
Culver
right over
kids.
That.
Oh, we're skipping. You want?
We are. We're going to have to
plan all the time.
I know.
Clever dog.
But you tried to bring her back.
What's the?
I'm not sure. I got an email in from the state, and there's going to be another kickoff meeting for equipment and so on. So I believe maybe we're going to have an actual kickoff meeting for culverts. So we'll just pass this to the next meeting.
Okay.
All right.
So Pat, would you make a note and please do put it on the next meeting that Chris either will have information or she'll be in deep trouble.
Right.
Okay, then the next, as I tried to say before, is the Williamsville Hall weatherization plans. What I said a note to Steve Levine is, look, there's $5,000 in the budget this year, plus whatever you can squeeze out of the budget for Williamsville Hall, period. Could you start looking into what would be a possible project, what you would propose to the board as what be done, which might well be that $5,000 isn't going to be enough, so it's going to have to roll over into the next year or whatever.
Mm-hmm. But
come on. So I see that they have begun those discussions. I think that they're only in their early stages, but they did, obviously, they talked about some priorities, insulating the ceiling at a cost of $6,800. Replacing many of the windows as possible, and lastly, rewiring the building estimated at $4,800. So what I would plan to do is, Steve says he'll contact the board and want to address the issue at our next meeting, the second April meeting. So Pat, if you make sure that they're, remind them that we're expecting some kind of proposal from them of what they would like.
Okay, I know that they said that they were going to have a few of the members here, but that is also their senior meals night.
On the 25th?
No, it's the 25th, so, and two of them will be cooking. So I'll ask them if they will have something in
mind. I'm a little confused. 14 and 4 is 28.
Their senior meals are at noon.
And 2 weeks from now would be the 18th, not the 25th.
Oh.
So could you get a hold of them and say it's really April 18th, not the 25th?
Okay.
And we would very much like them to come and give us some concrete. The more concrete in terms of, I don't mean literal concrete, the more concrete the proposal could be, the better.
Okay.
Okay. In terms of what the and do let them know. It may be that maybe they want to say we want to study to do this year, that next year, you know, whatever.
I talked to Brooks Mitchell from Brooks Mitchell Plumbing Heating Furnace the other day.
Right. Oh, that's
he
right.
We want to come down and look at it. We want to bring it before the board first. He thinks it's airbound.
Uh-huh.
That's why it's not heating. Uh-huh. He also thinks that there's some sort of a valve in there that never should have been put in it.
Oh boy.
He said he thinks he can straighten it out fairly easy, but I was going to bring it up to you guys, see what you want to do with it.
Well, then
probably would save fuel, right?
Well,
it's a disaster right now.
Yeah.
So I would, I'm certainly, so do we, I don't know, do you feel like you need a motion or something?
I was just going to let you know if you wanted me to do it, I'd get a hold of him.
I just would talk to the Williamsville Hall Committee,
Because
I think it does probably come out of their, where the budget line is probably their budget line. So if you talk to Steve or whoever, make sure they're aware.
Or do we have a separate line to the heating? I thought we had separate.
Do we? I don't know. I don't recall.
Budget for heating.
But that's,
yeah.
I don't know if it's quite, I guess it is part of this, because maintenance of the heat, anyway, it, independent of that, we just want them involved in the loop. And because even if since we, if we do have a line for the heating, then we can probably pull it out of that, which would even if we go over, would then not come out of their direct operating budget.
Because it's still sucking down the fuel pretty well, just taking half or something.
I'm going to try to see if I find dollars, but I see you're looking it up, so we don't have to both look it up, so I will stop.
They did also ask that we that I run this by you. Okay. They want to, because their members are not really able to clean the way that they want to have clean, they've contacted Melissa Brown, who does our cleaning here, and she's talked to them about cleaning pretty much the kitchen, and they want cleaning done following each meal that they have at senior meals at $20.
Okay. All right. They have a budget, and they're really just informing us of how they want to spend some of that money. And certainly, I don't have any objection.
Four segregations here.
Well, Williamsville, Chris has brought to my attention what we did in our budget. Williamsville Hall expense, and that's just $1,500. Hall groundskeeping, not too relevant. Heat, not a lot. $1,000. That was intended primarily for oil.
I think I don't.
And
think
lowered
that much
to
money.
Yeah to seven. No,
yeah,
no. We put this the heat. Which line is which? We lowered it to 750 based on our expectation.
I think there was a. Maybe it didn't get filled up.
Yeah, there was a whole thing.
Filled up at the end. And
right, so we didn't think this fiscal year.
It was
but bottom line,
it's
silly for us to be wasting money.
Right.
So let's get it looked at. But then in that case, I don't, other than letting them know that we're doing it, and then I don't think it's their
which
concern.
Which pack? All one of them.
Yeah.
But yeah, I would
so
definitely
Pat
like
yourself.
That.
Right. Yeah, Pat. Yeah. Probably yeah. Pat okay. is really the appropriate person. Okay, now the Hunter Bridge bids opening is postponed April 18th until SVE postpones it again.
People are calling, you know, and I put them through to Pat, but sometimes.
Okay, so let me give everyone an update on Hunter Brook Bridge, which will. Ultimately apply to
I want to talk about all the bridges
Lynch Bridge.
At this point.
So what's happening right now is there's been an issue around the state with the repair of the bridges where Agency of Natural Resources is saying they want certain criteria done to the banks of these brooks, right? Because they're widened out.
Right.
They're obviously wider than where the bridge was spanning in the case of Hunter Brook and on Lynch Bridge. So they have requirements, and then our Agency of Transportation has codes and standards for the building of these bridges.
Mm-hmm.
FEMA basically has put their feet into the ground and said, we don't care whether you need 10 more feet to span the new widened out area. We're only paying for what you had before, and we're paying for the same material that you had before. That's it. So this is kind of a big argument. What is going on right now is we took the set of plans, they're back up at the Agency of Transportation, and we're going to try to sit down and get a very composite plan of what it is we need to do for Hunter Brook and present it to FEMA anyway, even if they won't pay totally for it, which is a good possibility.
Then it becomes an improved product.
It's an improved appeal because we have the weight of the state hopefully behind us.
Just to be really clear, my understanding, and just to be sure, is that it's not strictly speaking an appeal. It is an improved project.
Right.
Then that covers us that we're doing something somewhat different from exactly what they authorized, and then if the amount ends up being, this is how I understand it now, if the amount comes in at what they obligated, we're okay. If it's not, we could end up having to pay the extra money, and then we could appeal that.
I'll give you, actually, Townsend, I think, might have been a good example, because theirs was obviously an improved project.
Right.
And they had to go through their last appeal, they finally prevailed.
Right.
That doesn't mean that the rest of us are going to prevail, right, because it's an individual appeal process. So the point is, John, currently we've had FEMA take a look at the Hunter Brook plan since the 1st of February, and they will not approve. So, well, the, improved project or not.
I don't know if we've ever, that's a very specific thing to file for an improved product. But bottom line, just to keep the public informed, Chris and I were going to have to figure out our strategy on what to do next in terms of who to push and how to push and what needs to be filed, et cetera, on both Hunter Brook and Lynch Bridge.
Right.
So is the bottom line that we have to wait in terms of bids because of this?
They really don't want us to wait, but I would let, I know. This
they drive
is kind
us
of,
crazy.
It's, they do drive us crazy.
For the record. Not for the record. No, not for the
We don't have a permit from Todd Denise.
So we haven't got a permit to do anything yet.
Right now what we're doing is we're waiting for kind of another roundtable discussion on this with Agency of Transportation and
at this moment the bidders though believe that their deadline is April 18th, right?
Correct. And we may just go ahead at that point as long as we know what we're looking at. We may go ahead and finish the bid process off at that point. Okay. That's why we're holding to it.
So for the, what about the Lynch Bridge
design? Can I just ask another one about Hunter?
Go ahead.
Hunter Brook, right now, you have accepted the bids. There are no more bids coming in. That seems to be several questions that have come to me. You know, I said no.
Let me be clear on this, because it confuses even me when I'm doing this. So right now, what we have out to bid is the contracting of the not just the bridge, the new permanent bridge, but also the removal of the maybe bridge, because that's another little process there. We are holding those bids up to make sure that the design plans and the contractor and you know how we put it to bid is exactly what needs to be before the bids are done.
Mm-hmm. So what you're saying is that you haven't received bids?
No.
No, we're literally not going to receive them until there are no more potential addendums to be made to those bids for those contractors.
Remember this, don't get confused between this and Lynch Bridge.
No, but this is definitely Hunter Brook. Somebody called to say after our last meeting, who got the bid? And I said, well, it was postponed.
That's correct.
And, you know.
For Hunter Brook, it was postponed.
And then there was another call that came and said, so are you still accepting bids? I said, I can't answer that because I didn't know if, you know, opening of the bid seems to me that you've already set a date for the bids to come in.
Do those calls go to Pat or are they referred? Okay, great.
Yeah.
Okay.
Was there a pre-bid?
Pre-bid meeting.
There's a pre-bid meeting. You probably can't accept any of the bids except for the ones that were at that pre-bid.
That's
correct.
That's true.
That's right.
Well,
only
when Gloria had that question, she should say no because you.
Well, she shouldn't say anything. She should pass it to Pat.
Right.
Well, yeah, but I mean that's what right. You should say to people is it
just that if
there
you
was
were
a pre-bid,
at, then you'll be able to.
Right. So if they were at the pre-bid meeting, then that's wide open. In fact, we've just been postponing when we're actually opening the bid, deadline for the bid.
Does other information and criteria require you to have another pre-bid?
No.
These are simply addendums to the original bid. There was a power line issue where we had to get Green Mountain Power out there to take a look at the removal and replacement of power lines because of certain cranes that would have to be used in this contract. Number two, the maybe bridge de-launch is the way contractors call it. That's what they call it, a de-launch. Okay.
Anybody speaking.
But anyway, it seemed more prudent and less costly to have the same contractor, once the permanent bridge is up, go over to the dismantling, de-launch of the maybe bridge and get that onto a truck back to where it needs to go. So that was another addendum that was put in there, too.
Okay.
And that includes cleanup of Maureen.
And then you had the restoration aspect of it, yes.
So all that's part of it, and and all of that, as of now, is set for April 18th. So as long as people were at the original mandatory meeting, then they're welcome to bid. And it's Pat who should be handling
And SBE is sending out those addendums
yes.
to
yes,
those.
Yes, SBE is in general.
Any postponement of a bid or addendums to the bid for correction or whatever are all done by SBE, and they are sent to those bidders that were at the pre-bid meeting.
Okay.
That's right.
Great. Now, Lynch Bridge design, where we accepted a bid, but we wanted to then meet with both the winning bid, which was SBE, and either Mark or John Alexander, someone from the AOT, was what we had hoped to do. So what's our status on that?
I think the first status approach on that is to let us see where we come out on Hunter Brook, because the state is also going to give us some advisement, I think, on Lynch Bridge. It's only
so you think they're
5,000 feet down the road.
Right. So what we really need to do is to kind of, in terms of talking to the state, be talking about both bridges and kind of clear it up before we go forward.
I think the strategy for moving forward needs to be put into place a little more securely, and then certainly the design, the engineer, he needs to be able to know then where we stand on
all this
thing. On all the scope of work required by FEMA.
Okay. All right. Yeah. Good. Very good. All right. And I will work with you on that going forward. Okay. The next order of business, unless there's anything further on bridges, on those two bridges, there is the request of treasurer reports, and as you may recall from last meeting, we talked briefly about treasurer reports, and the question, and I'd ask each of the board to think about whether there were specific things that you would like, either on a one-time basis, a quarterly basis, or a yearly basis, or a month, I forgot whether I said monthly or not, from the treasurer. Are there any reports that we would like to be seeing I apologize. There's one piece I would like to cover related to the bridges. One of the things, I don't know if you're still feeling like this, but Chris had talked to me at some point. She's been signing a lot of the documents that go to FEMA, and that we wanted a motion that kind of authorizes you to represent the board on those documents. Yeah, so it's been moved. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
I would like to say that in most all cases, what I'm trying to do is make it so that Pat is the signatory for continuity purposes. Mm-hmm. That way there's somebody else and then a signatory. But there have been a couple of cases where I've had no choice, but we got to move something.
We got to get it out.
And I just want to make sure that the public is very well aware of that, and the board as well.
Okay, so that makes sense to me.
Yep.
Are there any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any abstentions or negatives? Passes unanimously. Well, okay. Well, as you will. Okay. Thank you. Now, moving to the requested reports from the treasurer, are there any thoughts that you have of reports that you would like, information you'd like to see, in terms of beyond what the treasurer currently gives us, monthly reports, gives us the, what I call the P&L, gives us the expenses and the whatever revenues, but mostly gives us the expenses.
See us keep on top of this capital.
Yeah, so you would like to see the capital fund balances
at least
quarterly,
because this seems to be where our biggest problem is.
Yeah,
that the capital money keeps getting put somewhere else, and we need to keep track of that a little bit better.
We don't know, but
But that, and that's kind of what, and if you go back to the auditor's report, it's part of what we're saying we're going to do a kind of better job of in the future is making sure that we are signing off on any movement of capital funds to cover anything.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one.
Capital. I could make a good recommendation, which will follow right in with the auditor's report totally. Any movements of corrections should really, the board should be alerted to that.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, if there's some kind of a change or something.
So any kind of check, change, corrections to the general ledger really should be reported to the board.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, do you think that those come only with, at the time of the audit, or are there corrections made?
Well, she may find, there have been occasions where she realizes, oh, remember the thing I found that was $6,700, what is this? And she, well, it was, this should have to move to there. If we had a little report that just said, this, then we would know what.
Yeah, so that's but that was after she'd worked with the auditors.
Okay.
So
okay.
I'm
fair
just
enough.
Wondering
fair
if
enough.
That.
It may be
maybe
mostly
we could find good. Out if she makes corrections, then could report. But I'm fairly sure when she stuck that huge amount in there, it was after the audit.
Do we care about it if it's a small amount? In other words, if she has to move $100 or $200, I mean, we're really talking.
When you're talking clerical errors, no, what we're talking about is corrections.
Uh-huh.
Okay, either because we're running in budget lines, okay?
Right.
So, for example, if we found that something in the highway department, there was money
else.
Taken out of one line item that shouldn't have been taken there, it happened inadvertently to be another one, the board should be alerted to that for the reason
sense.
Of making sure that the it's corrected on paper.
Mm-hmm. And then we
everybody
know.
Everybody knows what happened.
And we know what happened. And
go.
The public, to the extent
exactly.
would knows, it knows
and
what
happened. And it's just fair human
enough.
Error most
fair
of the
enough.
Time, you know what I mean?
Okay. Any other things that...
There are a couple of, or at least two areas that I know of. For example, the town clerk has a preservation, restoration fund. And then I know that the listers have, for our next appraisal, that there are bunches of money sitting there that I don't know how much is there. Are we able to get, like, that figure every month?
Are they funds? Where
See,
does that money sit, or is it part of the general fund? Or is it a, what is it? Is
are they
it a
segregated
budget line?
Funds?
How is it?
If, at least the preservation is segregated. I think that the appraisal, because every year the town gets X amount per parcel that's put in for reappraisal.
So what? It's changes to those lines that you'd like to see.
Well, I'd like to know, for example, for every $10 that comes in per page of recording, a dollar is put into this preservation fund so that I can, or the town clerk, can do something, bind an old maps or, you know, do whatever needs to be done with that. So I never know exactly how much money I have in there because the state dips it in, sends all of their tax liens directly to the treasurer.
Okay.
It doesn't come through my...
Understood. If you could just send me an email and see if you can find where it is in here, then I would be happy to communicate that. I guess the only other thing that I came up with that I feel is the, I would like to know any loan status. Now, what Maureen told me is that we're actually able now, because we received a large tax payment in, to pay off the last of our flood loans, which is really quite a moment in time, if you will. Whether it's truly the last, meaning since we've got two bridges to build, is probably not really, we can't really put a true
but it's,
period.
It's a,
but
it's a significant
it is notable that we've reached that point. But I really feel like we need to know at any given time what loans we have out and what the dates are. Yeah. Because it, sometimes it seems like it catches it by surprise when we'll get the, do you realize this comes due? And it, I don't like it as a big exclamation point. I like it as a keeping track of it. So that would be one I would like to see. She said in terms of any vehicle loans, anything like that, that that really is tracked by the administrative assistant. Is that accurate from your perspective, Pat?
I'm not tracking it. She's taking care of those as they become due.
Right. She pays them. But I, what I would like to have, and it may be a matter of you working with her a little bit.
Okay.
But I would like, whether it's from her or from you, to know what do, you know, what does it look like on a, you know, quarterly basis. It doesn't have to be even monthly, but just on a quarterly basis. How much do we still owe? How much have we paid off? What do we pay a month? So we know kind of what's happening, you know? All right?
Okay.
Okay, so if you would kind of look into that and work out with her, so we cover 100% of the territory is what I'm looking for.
Exactly.
I don't care too much which is AA and which is treasurer, but that we have 100% of the loans that are out. Okay, so I think that's probably enough to get started, and it's not like a one-shot deal. If there are other things that people come up with and say, I'd really like to have a better understanding of this. And Maureen has always said that she, if we put it, if we have a question, if we could put it in writing and getting it to her in advance, and I honestly think that's a fair request because she has to look it up and figure it out.
Right.
I just always feed those to Pat, and I would appreciate it if you'd CC me so I'm aware of it. But I encourage board members to, you know, kind of, let's keep our eye on the checkbook, so to speak. And
I was wondering, too, there are some, and I'll go through, where we don't really know, I don't know. We say, where are we going to get the money for this, and kind of tuck it into a line item. But historically, what's paid for out of, I mean, it's fairly obvious recording, you know, what's paid for out of that. But when you get down to some of these other things, sort of, they're not miscellaneous line items, but it's small town well, office equipment or.
I think that when we have the, what do you call them, the when we pay orders, I do think that doesn't it say on them what. Line, does it say on what line it's coming out of?
I think she does.
Yeah, so account AC charge, town office. So it is here in the packet that we receive. That is
and
one.
Here's your listing right here. So if you look
yes,
it up,
the open.
There's this, where it's going to
so
go.
So you also can
wise.
See it. Mm-hmm. So there is that. Now, if we wanted any kind of summary report or something, we'd have to kind of think ourselves how we would want it formatted, what we would like.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Anything further in terms of the treasurer reports? Okay, moving along. The next item of business is the town vault. The lock was, I know that the lock combination was changed. So I think that the question is who needs to have the combination to the vault.
Who has it now?
The town clerk and the two assistant town clerks. And they're really the only ones who need to have the combination. There are very few that I know of any other towns that provide the combination to anybody outside that.
Hmm. But isn't there some stuff that's stored near that Pat might need?
Yeah, and then she can.
But if you're not, nobody's here Friday, how's she going to get to it?
She need to let me
what
know.
What was the purpose of changing?
Mom, because I decided it was time to be changed. And right now you're addressing the town clerk, and I'm really, it was my choice, and I changed the combination.
Yeah.
Well, it's the town's vault.
The select board has the right to say what you do in the vault in terms of any additions of shelving, et cetera, but. The combination is the town clerk's.
On what basis do you say that, Gloria?
Well, if you want me to, I'll have to go in and find the state statute.
But. Well, I did check with Jim Barlow today, and it did stump him a little. But what he said was that the town offices as a whole, all the space that's here is ultimately under the select board's aegis, including the locks there too. So I don't quite see why, a reasoning why the select board would not be able to, you know, know that combination and to also be able to determine who should have that combination.
No.
I would really, let me put it slightly differently. If there is a statute, Jim was not aware of it. That doesn't mean it doesn't exist. But if they're failing there being a statute saying specifically that the town vault is the responsibility of the town clerk to, in terms of its security to 100%, and that person has all decision-making responsibility around that, we really, my understanding of it is there's not a good reason that someone on the select board should not have that, or the select board could not designate that the administrative assistant therefore have that. So I think we need that. To put it differently, I don't think it's urgent that we resolve it tonight. I don't have anything in writing, and it doesn't. So if you could dig into it further, if there's a statute that says so. But my understanding, it literally is possible. We could change the locks on the front door if the select board decided to, which we're not about to, obviously. Yes?
What I'm curious about is there was obviously a reason why you changed the vault. You don't want anybody else going into the vault. Are there problems? Does this have anything to do with the records? Or
no.
It has nothing to do with that?
No.
Well, you know, here's another question. I mean, you know, sometimes on a Friday I'm in here and I need to access those closeout binders for FEMA.
Yeah,
so how am I supposed to get them?
I do think the vault is not, I mean, I'm definitely of the opinion, and I say it only as opinion, that and as I say, and it is based a little bit on talking to the senior staff attorney at the VLCT, that this is ultimately is there, the vault is a town asset ultimately, and not strictly, though that's obviously the town clerk has to have access to it. But I'm not clear why we wouldn't have the select board have access to the vault.
I just really want to know, has there been a problem with missing records, missing documents, people other than yourself who has the combination or your assistants, where there is any issues with the records in this town? Is that the reason for the changing of the vault? It is not.
Well, Gloria did answer that.
I just wanted to make sure.
She did say that.
I thought maybe it's because of the missing, didn't we have missing documents? I thought maybe that's why you changed it.
No. All right, let's not, I don't want to rehash things we have talked about.
In the pay orders, Maureen said that it should have been approved by the select board.
Yeah, I noticed that we got a copy. And I'll pay the extra $50 if I need to.
That's not the point. Don't expect you to pay that $50.
Well, I think, you know, we've never had a very clear policy about exactly how much money needs approval. I think the issue is, the bigger issue is, that it is very likely that the select board, I don't see why the select board would not have access to the vault, and we can postpone it till the next meeting, but seeing some strong literally legal statute, I would definitely say that the select board, and it's very simple, and it's not a, you know, so I'd rather not escalate the issue. Let's just, you know.
But in the meantime, could I just ask the board, in all seriousness, could I remove those binders that we're required to and put them into that over there so that at least I don't have to hassle with being able to get to them?
Is that, do you consider that a decent solution in the interim?
Well, I don't know, but I mean, if I was to try to come over here and I can't...
It's not locked, right? Just, you can't lock?
We don't want to lock it.
You can, we don't want to because
we don't want to lock it because of the danger that it stays locked and would then cost us $1,000.
I'm more worried about fire, really.
Well, if you're worried about fire, that...
Then that would have to be locked.
Oh, that's not fireproof unless it's locked.
That's what you said, Pat, right?
Right, that's right. That was the... If you could just work on it with him, the situation for the 2 weeks, and you know, and if you have to be here on Friday, let Gloria know. And I mean, I think
I can
we can
take him out Thursday.
But
I can
come in for a certain time period too.
Okay, but I do think we'll need to see something that suggests that. That we did, because I do think this. That from what I am, the rough understanding I have is it's the towns as opposed to explicitly under the. But it could be wrong. And
well,
I'm,
we
this is the first time its lock's been changed quite a while. Though,
since I took it was took changed over. The day that I took office.
I mean, because I could see it being changed from one to another.
But mm-hmm.
That's not a problem.
Right.
It just acts. It just we need to know.
Well, like you said, I mean,
and probably until this flood type of thing, nobody would ever have to would come in on a day that I'm not here to use documents that are being kept in there because
well,
of
titles,
the fire.
Titles.
Right.
Someone,
I see you being in charge of you know letting people in who you want in there, but. And it's just like Chrissy said. I mean, she's putting a lot of time. I don't know if you get paid for all that or not, but
she doesn't. Well. Minimum wage.
I was going to say, I mean, you put a damn lot of time into it, and if you can do it on that day, I mean, like I said, you and her work it out. And ain't nothing I want to know the combination to it. But,
I don't even think that's also the greater point. If historically the board, for whatever, I mean, I don't know how it's gone, but if there's been an abrupt change I think, first of all, we got to know why and what's going on, and then if the access to, say, the administrative assistant or however it is now all of a sudden abruptly changed. I really feel like we need to know what's up.
I do too.
That's it. I mean...
And I think if it happened the other way around, that Glory would want to know what was up.
Well, yeah.
Well, imagine we did it the other way. Glory, you would be extraordinarily upset, as I would think you rightfully would be, if somehow the board ordered the combination of that vault changed and you couldn't get into it, then you would have a heck of a time
well,
doing
some,
the job.
Some other discussion that's gone on our MuniNet is that there are town clerk's offices that where the select board cannot even get into the office unless you're there. Therefore, you couldn't get into that office, and you then therefore couldn't get into the vault.
But Gloria, I'm sorry, but the thing that I'm not hearing from you is the why you wouldn't wish the select board to have access to the vault. I'm not hearing a reason apart from I'm not hearing your thinking process.
And at this point, I prefer not to say.
Okay,
what's wrong with this vault?
It's the door, if they lock it, the tumbler could go off and it would cause
freeze, and it's like, we had somebody in here.
He said that we
had somebody in here and he looked at it and said, you know, he fixed it enough that we could at least close it.
But
if we lock it, it could easily stay jammed lock, and it would be quite expensive, like $1,000 or more dollars to get into that thing. So it's kind of not usable as a reasonable lock space. And as it stands now, the vault is really our only space to put documents like titles and it's a lock space, titles for vehicles and so on, and registrations. And for the FEMA documents that we don't want to mess with by anybody under any condition other than authorized people. So I'm quite willing to postpone it for 2 weeks, but I think we really need to resolve this at the next meeting. Okay, is that
okay?
Okay. Okay.
What's Chrissy doing? Tell her.
I'm sorry.
I can get them out. If I need, trust me, if I need to get them, I will get them.
Dynamite.
First person to break into a town vault. Okay. Unfinished business. Is having seen none there. And then correspondence. I see Henry Pinkney. Didn't we talk
about
him?
Actually, all of those are suggestions for the town offices.
I see.
And Priscilla knows that I have them, but they've been coming in two or three a week.
From him?
From him.
Well, all right. So,
send
them over there.
I'm holding on to them, and I'll get them to Gunther tonight.
Yeah, just give them to Gunther. Pass them.
And
Pat, I think you can pass them right on to that committee without. I don't have, you know, any need to see them.
Well, he seems to think that you can do double wide up.
Whatever, I'm not worrying about
it. Give them to you.
It's all your guys. You guys can have fun.
Thank you.
Okay. Gives them some entertainment.
Yeah, whatever it is, it's good. I mean, and we want people. And honestly, you know, I don't want to be at all negative about it. If someone has suggestions and they want to make them, that's terrific, and they should go to the right place, which is the committee that's working on the project. Okay, that completes the agenda I have. Unless Pat, do you have any administrative stuff that we should be aware of?
The Energy Sitting Commission public hearing.
Where is that? Whoops, I don't see it. I'm looking at an agenda that got. Okay, that's ICE actually, and I had sent that on to Pat and asked her to include it. Which is just. Let me see if I can find it. It's just a. I know what it is. On the 8th, as in. 4 days, is that right?
It's the energy generation.
Yeah, it's just to make you aware, that's all. I had received a note, and I got it from a couple sources.
Here you go.
Gloria had passed it on to me, but I'd also received it initially. Just there is a meeting somewhere in Brattleboro, and you can find out where it is by going to the site that they've listed on this piece of paper, which I'll pass around in a second. But it's just basically there. It's reminiscent of our issues with the cell tower siting. They're basically taking public testimony, you might say. I don't think that's literally what it is. But they're taking some input, is the way they put it, on from the public about decisions of where to site energy projects. Obviously, the big issue was the whole wind issue,
yeah.
And so there is a conference on, it does say 4/8, which I guess what is that, is that Monday, 5:30 to 7:30. If anyone is interested in attending and speaking, I will not be attending this meeting, but just to make people aware that that's really all the point of that.
It just seems to me via video conferencing,
right. Right, so I think what they'll have is
Brattleboro,
right. And they'll have a TV camera so people can see each other and communicate. Okay, that is the final item of business on the agenda.
Did we have, John, I think I forwarded to you the flood recovery officer, Brattleboro Development Credit Corporation, so that there's business, and I suggested we needed to try to get some business people.
Yes. The problem, let me see if I can find that email.
It's right here.
Oh, do you have it? Oh, great. Thank you. Gloria forwarded this to me that Anthony Summers, he was going to come here actually the day when we had some huge snowstorm. He was actually going to come to Newfane and talk with us. We would like to talk to him, is the bottom line. I would like to talk to him. So, Gloria, if you want to just follow it up and get him it would be good to talk to him to see what they can come up with as resources.
Yeah, if we can, that's great.
Okay. All right. That concludes our regular business and leads us to pay orders. Thank everyone for coming and